All right, Danielle Tucker, I am so excited that you're here. Welcome.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here. I'm a longtime listener, so I'm super honored to be here with you. Thank you.
Oh, wonderful. Great. Well, I'm happy that we connected. So thanks for listening and all of that. So let's get right into it. Where are you from? Where did you grow up?
Well, I was born in Arlington, Texas. Spent a few years of my early years in Texas, and then we moved to the East Coast for a minute. We lived in Pittsburgh and New Jersey, but I believe around my middle school age, we moved back to California, and I've been in San Diego now for, 25 years, I want to say, maybe more. But yeah, I consider San Diego my hometown.
I love San Diego. Oh my gosh. So how did music come into your life? Was your family musical or?
Well, my grandmother was a professional singer, but we always lived rather far from each other. So I didn't really have a ton of influence from her. But my parents, my brothers were not musical at all. So I was kind of, the different one, I guess. And it's just something that I naturally loved from the time I was a child, and then started singing at the church and kind of learning my way around the choir and ensemble singing that way. And my parents were just really, really supportive of everything that I did. They didn't know anything about the music business or what to do for me, but they always indulged me. You know, if I wanted to do something, if I wanted to do a talent show or pageant or something, they were always happy, you know, to do whatever they needed to do. And and then I think my career kind of really kicked off. I was on Star Search when I was about 13, 14 years old. And I think that was probably the moment that my parents thought, okay, maybe she can do something with this.
Nice. What was Star Search like? I used to watch that show. So.
Yeah. It was a great experience. I mean, I was so young. One of the things that stands out to me is we take for granted that with kids don't know a lot of repertoire. I mean, they're pretty fresh to, you know, music, and I certainly was. So I went in expecting to sing a song or two that I knew really well and had practiced and prepared. But as it goes in TV, it doesn't work that way. They gave me a list of songs that I had never seen in my entire life. And so that was, you know, that was kind of a moment of pressure. And so I ended up singing Roberta Flack's The First Time Ever I Saw Your Face.
Oh, wow.
Was a rather mature song for
a
13, 14-year-old. So that was kind of funny. All right, I got to get my power here. The guy that I competed against was phenomenal. So it was, you know, really exciting to, you know, get to work with someone like him. And it was Chas Lamar Shepherd. So he went on to win the whole series. And since then, you know, he's been in TV and music. He was on Seventh Heaven and the Temptations movie, all kinds of stuff that he's done. So it was a good experience. And I think it kind of gave me that boost of confidence that, you know, that I was on the right track, you know, that this was something I could really pursue.
Yeah. So how did you kind of navigate a career after that?
Well, it, like I said, my parents had no idea what to do with me. They didn't have any experience with that. So, I think I've just always been kind of scrappy from the time I was a kid, and I was always looking for opportunities, you know, always participating in school choir and, church choir, everything that was singing related. And I think I had joined a few girl group ensembles as a teenager and kind of got a taste for the live performing aspects of things and love that a lot. I was studying voice with an instructor named Tercilla Romero, who's still here in San Diego. And she really helped me get my start. I did a lot of girl group with her, and then she kind of took me on as a as an apprentice to work in her vocal studio. So I was able to kind of help and get a feel for that. And then, gosh, I think when I was fresh out of high school, I joined a service, and it wasn't exactly an agency, but it was a service where you would call and they would have a recorded message of available gigs that you could, you know, potentially audition for.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So every day I'd get on the phone and call, and this is so old school, but you know, I'd listen to the message and I would write and write and write all the information down. Then I'd have to call back and listen to the info again. But that kind of landed me my first real professional job, which was working in a show band that was on the East Coast. So I was completely green. I'm like 18 years old and fly from San Diego all the way to the East Coast. And we were doing shows all the way from, oh my gosh, Ocean City, Maryland, all the way down to Florida. I mean, it was every day, two times a day, we would perform at a resort during the day, and then we would perform at a club at night. So I learned so much in that situation. It was a crazy first gig to jump into, but I mean, the guys in the band taught me so, so much. And, you know, by the time I returned to San Diego, I just was, you know, experimenting with various bands and continued doing church singing. And then I felt like I needed to get my music degree. I felt like that was going to be a really, you know, important aspect to my career. I felt that that might be the thing that was lacking, you know, for me to really make money at it, and consider it a serious career. But so I ended up going to Azusa Pacific University as a vocal major.
I almost went there.
Yeah. I got accepted. Oh, such a great music school.
Yeah.
Really, really great. And I had a really fun experience there, but I got sick. I got sick with an autoimmune disease while I was there and had to return home for my treatments and everything. And it was, you know, was a very long process. And by the time I was well enough to return to school, I was already just involved in real life. You know, I had a job. You know, I was in a position where my parents weren't really able to continue paying private university, you know, payments. So ultimately I ended up not going back and continued pursuing, you know, the band life, doing cover bands and everything. And all the while I'd been working for this big church that had an incredible music program. I knew the band. They had really become family to me. And I, well, I guess I should back up, because I did end up deciding to do an original project right after school.
Yeah.
And so I went to Nashville, recorded an EP there, came home to promote the EP and kind of, you know, do some live shows to support it. And that went really well. But the guys that I had met in the church band, they ended up being the support band for the project.
Oh.
And they also kind of simultaneously were starting this corporate show band, which was the Mighty Untouchables. And
okay.
So we kind of formed, and it's been 12 years now, and it's been incredible. I mean, it's a wonderful band, and it's, you know, blessed me with a full-time career in music. So.
That's amazing. And, you know, I wanted to ask you about that because I mean, that's ultimately, you know, what we want is a full-time career. So how did things work? Just making that really a working band. I saw that on your website that you guys have done 1,000+ gigs, which means you're, you know, if you've been together about, you know, a little over a decade, you're working pretty often, you know. So how does all that work with the booking and just having the right, all the right elements, the getting the band together, rehearsing them, making sure that you're playing current songs, you know, all of it. How does all of that work for you guys?
I think from the get-go, we had a great combination of people who were really bringing something super valuable to the table. Our band leader, Mark Fulton, we call him Hustle Boy because he is the one that is out there. He's on the phone every single day, generating work for us. I mean, he is just dedicated to it 24/7. So we kind of had his hustle, and I had a background in business, so I was trying to handle all of our operational things, contracts, and the real, non-sexy things of a business. And then our drummer, who is also the MD of the band, he's an incredibly gifted musician and a great leader. So he really took the reins there. And then, the rest of the crew they just were all in. And I think from the beginning, we wanted it to be an arrangement where it was a very democratic arrangement where everyone always had a say in what we were doing or could weigh in and have a sense of ownership with the group, that it was, really something special to them. And so, ultimately, we defer to Mark's final call on stuff if we need to. But we've always handled business that way, and I think that that has helped us retain all of our members. Yeah, and then I think one other really different thing that we do is, as a group, we have a commitment that our gigs kind of trump all others that may come up for us. We all have our side projects and do other gigs and everything, but when it comes down to it, if the band gets a gig, not often last minute or anything like that, we've all agreed that we would make it the priority. And I think that that has really helped in our success because we're showing up as the same group all the time. So what people are, what we're marketing to our clients is what they're getting. We don't have a lot of subs that step in. And that has been, I think, one of the keys to our success. And we just keep it very family oriented. We're super tight all through the pandemic. We all stayed in touch and met regularly over Zoom. And I really think that that's how we keep it together. We have wonderful times and not wonderful times, just like any family does, but we always kind of work it out, and we have really stuck through it for a long time and had a great run at it. If we do 120 to 150 shows a year in non-COVID times, so we stay busy and we stay really happy.
That's great. I love to hear that. I love to hear that. I think the strong leadership, everybody being dedicated, you know, everybody understanding kind of what their and accepting kind of what their role is, and you know, just really supporting each other. And like you say, there's nothing's perfect. We're all human and everything like that. But I think if you, I just love that. Come together at the end of the day, can get through your stuff in a mature way, then things can stay together. So yeah, I love that. I love to hear that. Okay, so I would love to talk to you about, you have a weekly show on Facebook that you're doing, and what was born from that, from doing that? How did it come up for you, and how has it progressed?
Well, just like most singers in our situation, when COVID hit and we went into quarantine, I was of that mindset that, well, this will blow over, everything's cool, and I kind of enjoyed a little bit of a break. But as time went on, that creative, productive side of me was, you know, really, really needing an outlet. I'm kind of I'm just that type where I've always got to be doing something. I always need to be engaged in some sort of a project. And so just the idea just kind of popped to me that I'm just going to do some live Facebook interviews with singer friends of mine and just go on and kind of, you know, chat about life and how quarantine has impacted us and, you know, things that they were doing to move forward or, you know, what their the ups and the downs of the whole thing. You know, to serve as a little source of inspiration for our little community. That started to grow. And I started thinking, you know, I think that this is something that could serve a larger audience because I really believe during that time, we needed some hope. We needed some really concrete solutions, not just, you know, throwing up a live stream in a tip jar, you know, which is cool. I mean, that's great, but it's not going to save our incomes, you know? So I decided that I was going to do this summit and bring together a bunch of speakers who were, you know, industry experts who specialized in an area of income. You know, so we could really focus on helping singers find a path forward for 2021 and kind of lay out the plans for that and to discover what the various streams of income could potentially be for them. This summit came together beautifully. The speaker lineup was epic. We had 1,500 attendees. And it was just wonderful. Everything was pre-recorded. So, you know, it was fun and everyone could watch the replays and everything. And it just built up so much momentum and I enjoyed the work so much. I love being involved in projects like this. It's just kind of, I'm in the zone with something like this.
Yeah.
I decided to do another. So, it's May 17, 18, 19, and it's kind of the same format, although this time we'll be doing it all live, which I'm really excited about
Nice.
Because I had attended a few live events on, you know, virtual events, and I just realized that the energy and engagement, there's just no comparison between the two of them. So I thought this would be a better route. And this time around, we're really focusing on, again, finding multiple streams of income, but really learning how to treat this like a business. Right. And, you know, being professional about it, even if you don't intend for it to be your sole source of income. I mean, even if you are a hobbyist musician, you still want to get opportunities. You still want to know the various platforms and ways that you can get your music out there. So it's totally relevant to someone who's not even a professional musician. And we're also going to be focusing a lot on financial literacy for musicians. You know, that's something I heard a lot about through quarantine, where when this all hit, none of us had savings. None of us knew how to find financial assistance. You know, none of us knew how to apply for unemployment or, you know, what to do to prevent ourselves from going into, you know, massive credit card debt during a time like this. And so, you know, I really wanted to bring on some industry experts who can speak to that and, you know, give more than the basics on how to set yourself up and protect yourself in a financial way. And but we're going to be talking about all kinds of subjects. I'm so excited because you are going to be one of our featured speakers.
Yay,
so
I am.
Thrilled to have you there.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah, but we've got a lot of really well-known vocal coaches that'll be there. We've got Natalie Weiss, who is the breaking down the riffs guru out there, and Malia Morris. Yeah,
nice.
Malia, she's, you know, getting huge on TikTok. Her TikToks are incredible. And we've got, I mean, real deal pro level musicians. We've got Wendy Wagner, who's going to be on talking about her career. She's wonderful. We'll have John Henney, who you recently
interviewed. Yes.
Yeah. And then we have, we've got some people who are more focused on the business aspects. We've got the CD Baby crew coming on, and they'll be talking about distributing your music. One of them will also be talking about Spotify playlists and how to, you know, get traction on Spotify, and a lot of others who are going to be focused on, you know, marketing your music. But I think we're hitting on a lot of different topics that really address the main things that we need to set ourselves up as professionals.
Mm.
Treat it like a serious business. So.
Mm.
Yeah.
I love that. I love the whole, you know, the idea about financial literacy. I mean, I know for myself that has been, you know, something that I've actually was, I mean, you know, it's been a crazy year, very painful in a lot of ways, but I think that, you know, one of the big things that I dealt with myself personally was my own financial literacy, was my own financial stability and financial health, you know.
Yeah.
And I know other singer friends of mine are in the same spot, and it just makes so much sense. The thing that I've noticed a lot is, and tell me if, you know, what you think about this, is, you know, my friend, when we were all on Facebook, we're like, how do we do this unemployment? I don't know how to file. It's confusing. You know, everybody's like freaking out. But I did notice, you know, my friends who are actors kind of had that dialed in. You know, I had a couple of friends who, it just always seemed to me like, you know, it's imperfect, of course, but there is, you know, there's the actors union, there's SAG, there's, you know, there's just like, there's a union, there's a pay scale, there, you know, there's like things set in place. My friend who had been acting for many years, who I actually interviewed on the show, who's also a singer, Josh Cruz, he's filed for unemployment as an actor. So he called me and, you know, he saw my post on Facebook and he was like, let me help you out. And so, you know, it just seems like when it comes to that kind of thing, acting can be unstable as well, but it just seems to me like there's a lot of things set in place so you can be a little bit more protected, you know. I don't know, is that something you've noticed? Do you have any thoughts on that? Or
Yeah. I think you're absolutely right. And I certainly was in the same boat, which is why I'm kind of taking this summit down that path. You know, I had my own needs for it. And I know that so many around me had the same needs. And acting is not really my world. So I'm not that familiar with, you know, the things that they have in place. But what I do believe is that there are way more resources available to us than we're aware of.
Yeah.
And there is a better way of managing the finances to protect yourself. I think, I can't speak for everybody, but for me, as a singer, you get paid when you work. And if you don't work, you don't get paid.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you tend to live very paycheck to paycheck, and it's the work can be a bit seasonal sometimes, or it can be feast or famine, and it's hard to project into the future. Okay, I'm gonna need to save this amount of money so that I'm okay in the fall, you know, when things are a little bit tighter. It's just not a structure that I really ever thought of. So this was a huge wake-up call, and you know, improving and really becoming more knowledgeable with finances was something I've always wanted to do, and this just kind of threw me into the fire, and I'm grateful for it. I really am.
Mm.
And I think that as singers and musicians, we really need to rewrite the narrative of this profession and kind of drop the starving artist mentality, because I just believe, especially now with everything, you know, so many things being available to us virtually, we have so much at our fingertips that we can take advantage of. And, you know, I don't think that you have to look at a career in music as, well, I'll love what I'm doing, but I'll never make above this capped amount of money, or I'm always going to live a very modest lifestyle. That doesn't have to be the truth. It doesn't have to be the truth. And I think it's just a shifting of the mindset and reframing how you approach your opportunities and the way you get gigs, the way you manage them, and kind of back to that whole thing of like, how do you treat this like a business?
Yeah.
We're all somewhat entrepreneurs, I think.
Absolutely.
Baseline. Yeah.
I mean, it also seems like, you know, if you know, you've got bands that you work with, you have, you know, the My Untouchables, which is your full-time gig, and I think also the Beach Girls, it looks like you're going to be gigging, like, now. Like, you've got several. I was looking at your website. I was like, wow, she's, like, back in it. Great. You know, that's, it gives me hope. Yes, that's wonderful. Yeah. But it seems like, how do those groups sort of approach that idea? Because I have been in the idea of, you know, that whole famine mentality, that we have to deprive ourselves so that we can get more on down the line eventually, which I feel is just kind of an unhealthy mentality. And it seems like that band doesn't have it. It seems like you guys are working full time. It looks like they're paying gigs. Your promo video is beautiful. It looks wonderful. It looks like you're playing in front of these, doing great gigs, big crowds. You've got everybody, you know, engaged with you as performers and all of that. But have you guys kind of had that discussion of, should we do this free gig or shouldn't we? Or was that ever even a question for you?
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. And this is really one of my favorite areas to talk about is, you know, setting rates and, you know, knowing the value of what you have to offer and how to price yourself as a band or a singer. We really went into this with the mindset of, we're going to be a high-end corporate band. That's what we're going to do. We don't, you know, we don't want to do too many bar gigs, club gigs, casino gigs, which are all awesome, but it just wasn't the goal of the band. So when we got started, we really had an agreement amongst us that we would do a few freebies if we had to, if it made sense, if we were going to get some sort of a return on it. And we would do some, you know, lower priced things just to get that traction going. But once we got going, we completely doubled down on the aspect of, we're a high end corporate band, and we have to, you know, that has to be the image that's projected when we're marketing ourselves. And so if, you know, we're playing a, you know, huge convention center for thousands of dollars one night, we can't have the next thing on our schedule be that we're playing at the local pub. It, you know, it kind of devalues what it is that we're doing. And so I think that's a very important component of it, is kind of knowing what is that market that you're targeting, and kind of making sure that everything that you're marketing is in alignment with that. But we've had so many times that we've gotten offers to play somewhere, but it really fell outside the scope of our pricing, and it's been hard because we have said no to, you know, certain things, and which is really hard. And I think that is something that is really so common, so typical in our industry, is we feel as though there's a shortage of work and that we've just got to take what we can get. And obviously these are rather different times right now. So, you know, in normal times, but what I have found is there is plenty of work to go around for everybody. And if you're not getting work, I think maybe it's a different question of, how are you approaching getting gigs? And how are you, are you on the phone during the day hunting things down, or are you just kind of waiting for opportunities to come along? I really think that is the thing that separates or puts a, block in front of you from getting the work. Mm. But also there's this pricing component to it where I don't think a lot of singers really understand the value of their time and what that is worth. We set these low hourly rates that are just not going to allow us to build any kind of financial future, build any kind of wealth off of. And we give into it because of FOMO and all the other things. But I really believe if you're gonna next level the way you're making money in this business, you need to establish what the value of your time and energy is, and what you're, the return that you're getting onto that. And it's considering things like, how much work do I have to do behind the scenes before I get to this gig? How many songs am I having to learn?
Yeah.
How many hours is that gonna take me? What is my commuting time? What, what kind of gear do I need to show up with? And, how much time did I spend in school investing my life, in becoming this level of a musician? And all of those things should come into play when we set our rates. And the most difficult thing to do is holding the line on those rates. But I think once you know what you're happy with, and I define happy by when you leave a gig, do you feel happy and satisfied with what you're walking away with? Or do you feel like you just got worked all night and you're walking away with hardly anything at all?
Yeah.
As individuals, we would only know, we'd only know that. But I think it's holding the line on that pricing and knowing that you may have to say no to a few things here and there. And it can take a little while to build up the clientele that's willing to pay, your rates or has the budget to do things like that. So there's a lot of things that go into it, but I think that as, we become more financially literate, we will understand these things a bit better. And I think this is really the year to establish those things, because a lot of venues are going to be crying poor, some legitimately so, and then there are going to be others who are, going to take a little bit more advantage of the situation. And I really think that this is a time where, we've got to hold the line on being professionals and knowing our value and really speaking that out into the market.
Right. Right. Yeah. Cause I think, I do think a bit about, what it's going to be like moving forward. Obviously things are going to take some time to get going, but, I guess we take into consideration, the fact that whatever venue or whoever wants to hire us has maybe experienced financial hardship this year, but we have too. So, we can't like completely disregard that. And there are some industries that have done very well because of what happened. They are doing better than they have ever done in life. And so we have to, and maybe those are people to like look at as far as, their corporate gigs and things like that. What are your thoughts about, that, kind of moving forward and what it's going to look like a year from now or 2 years from now?
Yeah, I completely agree with you. And I think, in our community, we were hit so brutally hard by this that we kind of we're looking through this lens of, of not having enough, and that, we tend to think that everybody is dealing with this hardship. And while, there are a lot, there are industries that got hit much harder than others. people still have money out there. Still, the world is still in circulation, and you may not be able to see it because the community you're immersed in is struggling so hard right now. But just to know that the reality is that, you know, there is money out there. And probably the biggest thing that prevented us, well, of course, the biggest thing that prevented us from getting it were the restrictions that were in place for, you know, events and stuff like that. But my prediction is, I'm hoping at least by summer, you know, maybe going into fall, I really think that that's when things are going to get rolling again for a lot of us. And I think after that, it's going to be nuts. I think it's going to be like gangbusters, because people are going to be hungry to have events and to party and to celebrate and to be back together again. So I'm anticipating it being probably the greatest year of our business. And you know, and I hope other people will look at it like that too. And that can kind of help also boost your confidence in holding the line on your rates, is just knowing that, you know, if you do have to say no to somebody because something wasn't, you know, within your price range, that another thing will come along, you know? And I think we're all in for good times ahead.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. I love that. There is hope. I think there's going to be a lot of exuberance really once things open. Absolutely. People are going to be here for it. Let me talk to you about your coaching, because I know that you do vocal coaching as well and career coaching, and I'd love for you to talk about, like, you know, the career coaching that you do with your students and just your thoughts on mindset for singers.
Yeah. I started coaching, as I mentioned earlier, I had my own vocal coach, Tricilla, earlier in life, and she kind of took me in and showed me the ropes, how to teach, how to lead ensembles, and, you know, help learn the fundamentals of music. And so all along, I've always been giving lessons throughout my career. And I think before COVID hit, probably about a year before, I really started thinking about my future and how I was going to plan for my future career. I'm 42. So I know I can perform as long as I want to, but as we all know in this industry, you know, sometimes things start slimming down, you know, as we age, but I hope that's not the case. But if it is, I wanted to be prepared for the future and decide what other things can I do that I would, you know, be very passionate about and love and be fulfilled. And teaching has always been one of those things. So over the next year, I just kind of slowly but surely grew my practice. I worked with all kinds of singers. I used, you know, multiple methods to that were, you know, appropriate for the singer. And I think over the year, it helped me really niche down with the singers that I work best with and that I feel I can help the most. And so I really love working with singers who are coming with a good solid knowledge of their voice, you know, and maybe have some experience and could use some conditioning and, you know, a few techniques here just to level up. But I love talking with them about growing their business and treating it like a business and, you know, getting inspired. And that's really my favorite aspect of it. I always, in my sessions, I want singers to leave feeling empowered and, you know, happy. And, you know, I want to see those smiles at the end of every session. I just, my goal with everybody that I work with is to just lift that veil, you know, so that they can see everything that is possible for them and then, you know, really give them the reins, empower them to take control of their careers and not wait for it to be served to them. not just to take what you get, you know. You've got to go out there and I get really fired up about working with singers like that.
Yeah. What do you think gets in our way the most as singers? What have you observed with your students?
You know, I really think, I think consistency is a big thing. Mm. I think we'll get hit with the bug of, I'm going to work on my voice right now, or I'm going to, you know, I'm going to get out there and I'm going to get some performances, and, you know, we'll get fired up for a little while, but then it kind of gets tiring or something distracts us. And so we, you know, we forget about it or kind of drop the ball on things. And then, you know, a few months later, we're fired up again, but we're having to start from ground zero, right? Whether that is getting gigs or working on your voice, conditioning your voice. So I think consistency is a huge thing. Mm. I think just general, you know, not really understanding the business and how that works. And I think maybe just knowing just how dedicated you do have to be to your craft. If you really, you know, if you really want to make a living at doing it. But I really think number one, it's the consistency and how we approach it.
Yeah. And it sounds like too, with every, you know, everything you've said with, you know, your successful group that you work with and all of it, that there has to be, it seems like there needs to be a very clear vision of what you'd like it to look like, you know, even if whatever, anything can happen, but you have to really sort of, it seems like you really need to know what you want. And like you're saying, need to be consistent in all of it.
Definitely. I completely agree. And I think it's a little bit different, depending upon what avenue of the business you're pursuing. If you're an original artist, or if you are, you know, a working singer, we kind of tend to be one or the other sometimes. You know, as an artist, I think original artists may have a little bit better grip sometimes on why they're doing something. Mm. You know, if it's their artistic outlet that, you know, that's really coming from a heart space. But when it comes to, you know, being a working singer, doing session work, corporate work, you know, whatever it is that you do, we kind of forget about what the why is behind what we're doing. And if that isn't strong enough or clear enough to you, I really think that's when we are most vulnerable to taking gigs that don't pay us well enough, or taking gigs that we don't necessarily like, you know. But I think if you have a really, really clear understanding as to why you're doing something or why you're taking a certain thing, then you walk into it with more of a sense of, you know, pride and ownership, and, yeah, and you walk out the same way, you know. But we do, we get trapped in that mindset sometimes of, you know, I'm a machine. I'll take as many gigs as I can get on the books and, you know, yeah, whatever puts $100 in my Venmo account tonight, I'm on it, you know?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah. That can be a little bit of a, it can be a little bit of a trap without a clear vision, consistent vision, for
I
sure.
I totally get it though.
Yeah. Gotta make that cheddar. Well, this has been really great. I've loved this conversation. I really enjoyed speaking with you. Please let us know where we can find you online, and where can we find out more about the Pandemic Proof Singer Summit?
Yeah, definitely. Well, you can find everything about me at danielletucker.com. All of my social links are up there. And right now I'm most active on Instagram, and my handle is Danielle Tucker Singer. And I, for the Pandemic Proof Singer Summit, I'm thinking you're going to provide a link, which is your affiliate link, in,
yes,
to everybody. So please use that link, and that'll take you straight to our registration page. It's free to attend. I mean, it's 3 days. It's going to be totally high energy, more information than you can possibly imagine in one sitting, and you get to pick and choose what you want to listen to. But definitely register for it, come and check it out. There will be some replays for 48 hours, so, you know, if you can't be there in person, just know that you can still watch the replays. But it's going to be amazing. Just click the link. that yes. you're providing. Yeah.
Yes, wonderful. The link will be available in the show notes for everybody. We'll have that. And Danielle, you've been wonderful. This is so good. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited today.
Me too.